हो गया है उसमें काम, मतलब ऐसी और 20-30 पॉइंट्स जैसे
घुमाना
मार्क्स
चाहता
गिरे
है
थे।
और
ठीक
कि नहीं?
है बॉटल हटा दे।
स्क्रीन शेयर करके देख। योर एक्चुअल थिंग गो टू द एक्चुअल स्क्रीन वे योर मीटिंग इज द एडिटर मीटिंग।
ठीक है,
शेयर स्क्रीन चलो पार्टिसिपेंट्स, लेट मी सी हूज देयर, हाउ मेनी पीपल हैव जॉइंड। नीचे आओ क्या। हाँ या वी शुड बी ओके, वी कैन गो टू दिस वन। मोर पीपल हैव जॉइंड, दैट्स ऑल राइट, यू कैन जस्ट गो अहेड एंड यू वांट टू वेट अ मिनट एंड देन वी कैन स्टार्ट। राइट, yeah, just keep it like that. At least you'll be able to see.
Some doesn't take a year.
This is our number of participants right now.
Okay.
Yeah. Do we want to go ahead and begin? We give them a minute. Good afternoon, everyone. We'll just take another minute and then we'll go ahead and start. Thank you for joining on time. This should be a very interesting session today. So we shouldn't have, we'll just give another minute and we'll just then go ahead and start. My request, just as always, just keep yourself on mute so that, you know, there's no other disturbance or interference in when someone's speaking. This session is being recorded. So in case anybody misses out on anything, it will go ahead and be shared later on as well. We'll try and post it somewhere where everyone can access it. But if there's anyone nearby, if there's more than one person somewhere, then you just let us know if more than one person has logged in one spot. You'll be able to see how many people there are at the top when you go to your sharing screen. It will drop down the number of participants for you. So I'll tell you when we can go. We'll just give it another minute and then you can start.
Yeah.
ऊपर चलिए,
यू कैन हियर कमिंग बैक फ्रॉम दिस।
हाउ मेनी इज शोइंग यू, हाउ मेनी इज
दिस जस्ट वन मिनट टाइम बिफोर यू स्टार्ट।
यस, जस्ट गो अहेड एंड स्टार्ट, इट्स ऑल राइट। चेंज दिस स्लाइड।
हेलो एवरीवन, My name is Moinuddin, and I'm head at FISCHEM and Analytical Chemistry Division of Dabur Research Foundation. And today's webinar is about overview of analytical chemistry and its role in the regulatory science. So, So this is the content of the today's presentation. We'll discuss about the introduction to analytical chemistry and role in industry, division of analytical chemistry, and regulatory requirement. So here we'll discuss about the introduction to analytical chemistry. So what is the analytical chemistry? So this is a science concerned with the systematic identification and characterization of the product. Means we should find out what is present in your product and what is the characterization and what is the property of that particular product. So it means this is a discipline about the information of the product, that what is the sample and what is in the sample. So the data which we are getting, it should be a high degree of the certainty. So in short, we can say this is the science of the chemical measurement. So when we think about the analytical chemistry, or we think means what is your product, then you will be having two questions in your mind. That is, what is in the sample and how much quantity is present in your sample. So in analytical terminology, we can say that this is a qualitative analysis, or this may be a quantitative analysis. So these are the objective of analytical chemistry. If we talk about the aim of analytical chemistry, so here we can divide into two, like intrinsic aim and extrinsic aim. So intrinsic aim means analytical information should be with a high quality and the low uncertainty. Means the data which we are getting from the experiment, so the variability from the different step of the experiment, it should be minimum. And the extrinsic aim is that for the biochemical information of any health industry or chemical industry, so they need to know about their product. So the method which we are developing for analyzing, for identification and quantification of compound, so how you are developing a method for that. So this is the extrinsic aim of the analytical chemistry. So if I divide from old technique to new technique, so I can divide here from the classical analytical technique or modern analytical technique. So classical analytical technique is required for most of the undergraduate level education and some of the industries laboratory. So these are the basic of the analytical chemistry, and the examples is gravimetry method and titration method. But the speed is very less in this type of methods, and the recovery is also less, and cannot do the low technique. So in modern analytical technique means there is an advancement in the computerized system, and the instrument like HPLC, GC, ICP is there. So we can do analysis by using this method, and we can select a technique based on the type of molecule. So nowadays these are used in the pharmaceutical industries, biotechnology, industrial chemical, and forensic science, and the environmental monitoring. And there are some hyphenated techniques like LC-MS, DC-MS, or ICP-MS. So by this we can generate the data. Means if we want to perform the hydrophobic screening, we can do hydrophobic screening by the LC-MS, DC-MS, or ICP-MS. And we can generate the multiple data from the sample or from single injection. So time saving will be there, and you will get the data with high accuracy and with low level detection. So what responsibility analytical chemist or lab should have to perform any method or to identify, quantify the product? So perform the analytical method necessary for the characterization of the product. So this is the first responsibility, means when we are performing, generating data for product, so product should tell about its property, means the strength, identity, purity, and the composition of the product. So this is the characterization of the product. Means, for example, if we are discussing about the suspensibility test of any compound. So your product is throughout distributed in the volume or not. So based on the type of product, you should characterize this. You should select a parameter that you are giving the complete information of your product. So design the setup and plan setup to conduct the stability studies, documentation and report lab results, troubleshoot refine analytical process, and provide analytical support to supply chain through reliable data, efficient analytical method, and effective problem solving. And work closely with the synthetic chemistry formulation department, quality assurance, discovery, and manufacturing. So this is a major role where analytical chemist or lab are playing. Means so there should be a proper communication with the different department function of organization. So the next step of the process is dependent on the analytical results. So there should be communication with the whole department function. So here the analytical chemist or lab is playing a very important role and conduct the product chemistry studies. They meet the worldwide regulatory requirement. So this one we'll discuss in the next slide. And provide solution to support the active content in the various type of formulation and for API product and as well as for the formulation products. So here is a role in industry. So analytical chemistry play a very important role in many industry in various aspects of the chemistry. Yes, these are the some type of the industries where analytical science is required. So for example, pharmaceutical product, medicinal use product and medical devices are there. So just to know the compound, what is the product and what is the content is present in the product. So analytical science is playing a role in the pharmaceutical industry for agrochemical monitoring of pesticide and plant production product. So here the analytical science is required for environmental science like air and water quality monitoring. For example, some of the chemical industry, there some effluent is coming out from the chemical industry and is going to their aquatic system or in ecosystem. So air and water quality system and water quality monitoring is required. For food industry, measurement of food quality, protein, fat, carbohydrate, and fatty acid. And there are many other parameters for the food industry where analytical chemistry is playing a role. For cosmeceutical, like quality of product and what is the effect on the skin and hair. So for that purpose, it's required in other industrial chemical monitoring of the intermediate dyes and biocides. So here also analytical chemistry plays a role. So if we discuss about with respect to the study, means what kind of study you should design. So here we can divide and we can discuss what type of safety study and what are the efficacy study is there. So you can design your experiment based on the type of the work. So for example, identification, quantification of the active content. So API and technical grade material is there. And the guideline we can follow is ICH, SAMPO, ABNT, and USCP. And for impurity profiling, identification of quantification of impurity, we can do ICH guidelines also there, 2-3 guidelines there. And if we are talking about the pesticide and agrochemical, there is a guideline SAMPO and USCP. So within that we can follow. For residue analysis of pesticide and crop protection product, guideline is SAMPO and USCPA. For bioanalysis, guidelines are ICH and guidance for industry and European Medical Agency. And for dose formulation analysis of toxicology and ecotoxicology related sample, guidelines we can follow SAMPO and ICH. And for physicochemical testing, that also include safety study on chemical. So in guidelines, you can select ABNT, SAMPO, USCPA, and CPAC. So the selection of the guideline here depends on means where you are going to submit your product. For fact-based analysis, guideline is SAMPO, ABNT, and USEPA. And for food testing, guidelines are AOC, BIS, and there are other regulations. For example, FSSAI manual is also there. So if we are going to submit our product, so we can select method from the FSSAI manual. Why analytical method validation? So this is a basic requirement of analytical science. Means when we are going to develop method for any product, it should be validated. So means we are going to analyze our product from any one of the instrument technique. So we should know that we are going to analyze our compound, and your product should fulfill its purpose, means for what we are going to design our study. So this is required to accurate analysis to ensure that you are giving quality and efficacy of the drug which is going into the market. And it is important to ensure that procedure will consistently produce the intent, a precise result with high degree of the accuracy. And analytical method development and validation is a requirement of the regulatory authority, and the regulatory authorities are both extensive and stringent. So which document you should follow? So there are many documents to perform the analytical method validation, like ICH-22R1, US EPA, OCSPP 17001800, SANCO, MNT. So we can select means any of these guidelines based on type of molecule and in which regulatory authority you are going to submit. So these are the parameters of analytical method validation, which is specificity, LOD, LOQ, and linearity, precision, and accuracy. So these are the minimum parameter which we should follow for analytical method validation, but this is not limited to. There are some more parameters you need to include based on type of study. For example, if you are doing dose concentration analysis of toxicology or ecotoxicology, so in that case, we should perform stability, homogeneity, and concentration analysis. If you are doing method for technical, yeah, so in that case, you no need to perform LOD and LOQ because we are going to identify and quantify the content which is present in more quantity. But in case of impurity, it is required because we are doing at very low level. In case of bioanalytical, pharmacokinetic, and toxicology, there are some many parameters which we should perform with respect to the stability of analyte in the matrix, like best of stability, free strong, and long-term stability. Apart from that, to just perform the method ruggedness, we can perform ruggedness and repeatability of the method. So that is a requirement of the different type of regulatory authority. So this is about the five-batch analysis. So we are providing method, our foundation, and why five-batch analysis is required. So this is necessary for the manufacturer to identify and quantify the impurity present in your product. The impurity which is more than 0.1% or equal to 0.1%, it should be identified and should be quantified. But if the impurity is toxicology relevant, so in that case, we should perform identification and quantification of the impurity, even if it is less than 0.1%. Or in case of solvent, we should perform, if we are able to detect and if we are able to quantify, we should go at a lower level as well. So the data which we are getting from the different impurity or active content, we should perform this experiment for 5 production batches. This is for the minimum regulatory closure. So what are the different phases of the 5-batch analysis? So first one is the preliminary screening, then identification of impurity and communication with the sponsor for identifiable impurity. So if impurity is present in the literature, then we should definitely identify and quantify it. But there are some impurity which may be from the confidential point of view, so we should discuss with the sponsor. So what may be the possible impurity is this. So so it is required at the preliminary screening stage that you are going to identify and quantify the all the impurities present in your product. So for analytical method validation, for active content as well as for impurity, you should perform for all impurities. And active content analysis of the 5 representative batches is required. So here is applicable guidelines. In US EPA, there are 2 different guidelines for preliminary analysis. There is guideline 17000, and for enforcement of analytical method, 18000. And SANCO 3030 for European submission. And for Brazilian submission, ABNT NBR 14029 guideline is there. So based on our type of means where we are going to submit our product, based on the regulatory requirement, we should select the guidelines, and the report format is also should select in this format. On for example, in case of EPA submission, it is required that you should submit your analytical report in a different part and the active content analysis data in the different part. But the study will remain same, but it should be submitted in two different formats. So this is the first step of the 5H analysis. This is preliminary screening. In preliminary screening, we should identify all possible impurities which is present in your product. So we can do screening by LC-MS or GC-MS. So preliminary screening should tell data about the impure peak and the pure peak. So by peak purity index, you can find out and you can separate. For example, in 3D chromatogram, you can see that there is a small peak which is not separated from the main compound. So this is a requirement of some of the regulatory authority like Brazil. You should submit your data in this format so that it can be easily traced that this the peak is completely separated or not, or your peak is pure or not. So by UV spectrum in PDA, you can find out the impurity, and mass spectrum in GC-MS and LC-MS, we can find out the impurity. So in next step, we can identify and quantify the product by using this data. So this is about the analytical validation and quantification of the different impurities. So these are the possible type of impurities. Organic impurities you can find out from HPLC, LC-MS and GC-MS, and solvent impurity from GC like hexane, inorganic impurity on ion chromatography, heavy metal analysis on ICP-MS or ICP-OES, water content by Karl Fischer titration. So these are the possible type of impurities. So whatever content we are getting from this technique or data should be presented in this format. So the sum of the all peak should be 98 to 102%. So this is the mass balance of the product. So we should keep the data for the 5 reproduction batches in this format. So this is another service which DRF is providing, this physicochemical analysis. So what is a physicochemical analysis? So this here, physical property and chemical property plays a role. Means if you are talking about a pharmaceutical product or any of the product, the physical and chemical properties play a very important role. So there's property, physical properties like appearance, like solubility, partition coefficient. So this will tell you about how it is behaving in the body, or if you are talking about the agrochemical product or chemical industry related product. So it will tell you what is the fate of your product in the soil, or in the how it is dissociating in the water, where it is persistent or not, durability in the environment, or what is the, what degradant it's getting from this type of product. So these are the physical properties, and there are some chemical properties like oxidizing properties, explodability, flammability is there. So that also we need to assess for submission in the regulatory authority. So if the product is moving from one place to another place, also in that case also we need to perform, we need to generate data for the physical and chemical property. So this is required for the minimum quality specification for giving its safe and effective use. So these are the formulation type. There are some solid formulation, there is some liquid formulation. So we can select related guideline based on the requirement of the regulatory authority. So there are many guidelines which we can follow, and multiple guidelines for the single product. So, but it depends, means what is the product and what in which regulatory authority we are going to submit this. So here I have just divided into a different group, like density properties. So pore density and tap density, we can perform in case of dispersion stability, there are some different studies or dispersant property will tell you means how your product is distributed throughout the volume where it's going to spray or apply in the crop. And volatilization property, like solution property, dissolution property, flow property, particulate fragmentation and adhesion property and surface property. So like this, there are 46 parameter which we can perform at our research foundation. Next. So this is not to perform all type of studies for the single product. It depends means which type of formulation this is and in which regulatory authority you are going to submit. So here I just mentioned about few of the studies which is required from the safety point of view. So when we see on the label of any product, so we can see that it's mentioned that whether your product is flammable, non-flammable, or if it is oxidizable or not. That depends on the data which you are generating from these particular type of studies. So we can perform the explosive properties by experimentation, like explosive by it may be by thermal or shock or mechanical and self heating and flash point flammability, oxidizing properties and the auto ignition properties. So by European Union and the US Occupational Safety and Health Administration, there are some classification system. Based on this classification and labeling system, we can give the label means your product is safe or not. So some of the regulatory authorities require this type of data when your product is going into that particular territory of any country, or if your product is going outside from the particular territory. So this type of data is required. So this is another service which DABA is providing. This is residue analysis. So the term residue is generally used to describe the amount of the agricultural chemical. So when we are spraying any product on the field, so how much it is retained on the crop or soil or in aquatic system. So we should monitor and we should identify. So regulators are very stringent, means we should submit data of our product that it is not retained in the aquatic system for long time. So regulatory authorities are suitability of the new formulation of pesticide. So what is the source of the contaminants from the site or agrochemical is coming?
Somebody has a mic on. Can somebody please, can everybody please make sure you're on mute? Somebody has their mic on?
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead.
So fungicide used to control the fungal disease in plant and plant products. There are insecticide which is used to control the insect pest in crop, and herbicide which is used to control the weed in crops. So these are the possible contaminants from which we can get the residue, and we should find out the residue for that. And what we should monitor, so which type of material we should select. So the plant matrix like water, the soil, meat, this matrix may be contaminated from the agrochemicals. And the residue, in case of residue, we should identify and quantify the parent compound and the toxic metabolites. So what type of analysis we can do just to monitor the residue in your food and crop. So there are single pesticide method and the multi-residue analysis. In single pesticide residue monitoring is required when you are monitoring the particular compound, what is the fate of that particular compound and what metabolite is getting from, what degradant is getting from the ecosystem. When we are doing analysis of the food products, so in this type of analysis we should select multi-residue method, because we don't know means from which type of which type of agrochemical this crop is treated. So for food product, multi-residue analysis is required. So So this is about the tolerance limit. So what is the tolerance limit? So some of the regulatory authority has given a document. In that document, they have mentioned that this MRL level, means residue, maximum residue limit is there for that particular product on the particular crop. So we should select our method that we are going to identify and quantify the product at that particular level. So there is the EPA document and the EC document. So we should follow this document. Analytical method validation. So here I am giving again an example. So here I am giving again an example of the analytical validation. So here limit of detection is also mentioned in the guidelines. So we should keep in mind that our method should be able to identify and quantify at LOQ level of that particular compound, and or as per the maximum residual limit. And guideline is SENCO and OCSPB. And these are the matrix group which you can select from here, and the matrix type you can select, and we should monitor our product and the animal matrix like milk, meat, bovine, poultry, egg, fat, and liver and kidney. And these are the acceptance criteria of the accuracy and precision. So guideline has mentioned about the accuracy and precision criteria. So outside this criteria also acceptable, but we should give the justification for that. So this is a very important parameter, independent laboratory validation. This is required when we are going to submit the first tolerance petition. Means first time we are going to define the MRL levels. In that case, ILB is required. So ILB, that means the first method is developed and validated by the one laboratory, and another laboratory should be confirmed that your method is able to identify, quantify at that particular level or not. So, and the second case is about the new tolerance limit when we are going to decide. In that case also, ILB is required. So the ILB laboratory should be separate from the primary laboratory. Applicant can also perform at their organization, but the location should be separate. Here is about the confirmation of the method. So the primary method, when we are doing on one technique, it should be confirmed by the another technique. For example, in case of HPLC, MS, or GCMS, we should perform with the additional fragment. So the analytical validation should be performed with the two different fragments. So these are the picture of the LCMS and GCMS, which we are having at DRF. These are the high-end equipment available at DRF. We have HPLC from Shimadzu, Agilent and Thermo, GCFID, IN, chromatography, ICP-MS, FTIR we have from Thermo, DSC-TGA from Metra Toledo, and UV spectrophotometer from Perkin. So these are the regulatory authorities for which we are working, and we have expertise that we generate data for these type of regulatory authorities. So this is about the EUD. So this is one of the regulation. So I would like to highlight here that DABR has expertise to perform experiment as per the requirement of the REACH registration. So the basic release is that means when we are any country going to submit their product in the particular EU region, so they should perform some particular set of studies, and it should submit to the EU REACH and the ICA. And what is the EU REACH? This is the registration and the evaluation, authorization and restriction of the chemical EC 1907/2006. And this is required for the importer, for manufacturer, for the different type of chemicals. So this is depend the type of the studies and the amount of the studies depends, means which tonnage quantity you are going to import or export from the EU territory. So there are some more regulations like REACH, which is coming in effect, means draft document is also there for the Indian REACH. So it will be released soon, maybe next year or next year. And definitely we will be providing service for the EU and the ADRT submission as well. These are the type of the material which we should identify and quantify, and we should certify for the EU resubmission. There is a monoconstituent and multi-constituent products, and the UVCB type of products. UVCB is a very challenging molecule for the analytical point of view. So we can generate data for the UVCB product as well. So these are the some elements for the food laboratory. As we discussed in the previous webinar, that we are OECD GLP compliant labs, and we should follow some regulations. So these are a few points, but these are not limited to see here. Once again, about the good quality practices which we should follow, and we perform the analytical experiment, and we develop the analytical technique. And we can do the analysis of the compound following the GLP regulation. And the basic requirement is like qualification of the test facility management and the personnel. And we should have SOP and the quality assurance program. So qualification of the analytical testing facility. So we have performed some experiment when we are going to establish any type of method in the facility. So we should validate that particular method. So this is the requirement of the good laboratory practices. So qualification and validation of the equipment system, computer and the computerized system, material and reagent, and test system, test item preparation, that is also a requirement of the OECD document. So this is an important parameter. So that also we should follow. Performance of the study and reporting of the study result, storage retention of the record and material, and documentation and maintenance of the record. This is all about the webinar. Thank you very much, and thank you for your attention.
Are there any questions anybody may have? We have a couple of minutes. If you have any questions on anything Moeen has spoken about, any doubts or questions? No. All right. Thank you everyone for your time and attention. We will see you at the next webinar. And take care. Thank you so much.
Thank you.